Today at 7:30 this morning, Tobias Harris will join us to talk about the Sixers' title chances. At 7:45, Kyle Rudolph will join us live from Vikings camp a little bit later. But the best reason to tune in is this guy right here, our favorite big-time guest, former
head coach,
Eric Mangini.
Eric, how's it going? Back. Good to be back.
Great to have you. We missed you.
They told like 8 people. Nick told 4. Jalen's got 3 other ones, and
just
you.
Him.
Oh man, you're our favorite. They've been going through this basketball season. They were
true.
Loving up on Antoine. Man, you are the best. Love you, Broussard. Love you.
Like.
Every time I turn on the show, a part of me dies because someone's like, okay. Oh, you're my favorite.
Well, resurrect yourself, my friend, because you're here now and we love you.
I am the favorite right now.
You are the favorite. Let's talk some Andrew Luck, favorite one, and the Indianapolis Colts. It was a nice bounce back year for Luck last season, that after a very few frustrating years dealing with injury, returned to lead the Colts back to the playoffs last season. However, Colts might have higher aspirations than just the measly playoffs. Colts owner Jim Irsay did not hold back, selling his fans on what this team can do.
This team is one of the best teams that I've had the privilege to bring to our fans with the general manager and head coach and have a situation that honestly matches some of those days of Peyton, Edger, and Reggie, all those guys. I couldn't be more excited, Bob. I think it's really exciting. Obviously, Andrew's in that sweet spot era for him, age-wise, and there's really not a lot of weakness, here with the roster.
Coach, best team since Peyton and Edgerrin and Reggie. Is this finally the Colts' year? Could it be?
They have as good a chance this year as I think anybody does. And I don't love the fact that the owner is creating these expectations. That's something that he could have done to help continue this path is lessen the expectations, because they're in a good spot. They're being talked about and justifiably so. When you look at what they did defensively, made huge strides, and then they drafted 7 guys on defense. Mm-hmm. And I think those guys are going to contribute significantly. Andrew Luck, he is a force multiplier. Andrew Luck is one of the best quarterbacks in the league. You've seen the progress that he's made coming off the injury. I like where they're positioned offensively. There's 3 number one draft picks on the offensive line. To me, they are in a great spot to make a huge jump this season. And with the salary cap room that they have and the way that they positioned the team and built this team, they could be successful long into the future because they've taken a long-term view of building the roster.
Yeah, Coach, you said a nugget there. I just don't want to pass over it. For those who watch us and everything, we become very comfortable with Coach Mangini. One of your favorite things is force multiplier. Explain that to us, what it means, especially for an NFL quarterback, and if you're going to be considered one of the best in the business, what you're expecting that guy to do.
Well, you can be a force multiplier a couple different ways. You can be a force multiplier where you make 5 guys around you better. You make the people around you better. You can be a force multiplier and that you make the people around you worse. It can go either way. But really, when you look at that quarterback position, when you insert that player, everybody around him becomes better. The receivers, Tom Brady is the classic example. Peyton Manning is another classic example of guys where it doesn't matter who plays receiver, they become better because of the way that he operates. The running back becomes better because they've got to deal with the quarterback. The offensive line becomes better because that player is in the position he's supposed to be in. He gets him to the right protection, things like that. You are someone who makes everybody around you a better player.
And I want to remind the audience about what the Colts did last year, how they got to the playoffs and ended up winning a playoff game. They were dead in the water. They were 1-5. The coach, the week before, they fell to 1-5 in what a lot of people thought was a desperate move, if you remember. Instead of taking the tie, which he could have against Houston, he went for it on a 4th down in his own territory because he knew they were in a spot where, man, we have to start winning games. They lost that one, then lost the following week as well. And then they won 9 of 10 to finish the year and a playoff game. So they won 10 out of their next 11 games. All of a sudden, they had a dominant defense in that stretch, aided a bit by the quarterbacks they went up against, but still a dominant defense. They're one of only 3 teams all year to not allow a 100-yard rusher. And most importantly, I think, is what you mentioned, that offensive line. They traded back from the 3rd pick to the 6th pick of that year's draft, still got their guy, Quentin Nelson. He was an instant Pro Bowl, if not all pro caliber player. And Andrew Luck, after the first five games of the season, was one of the least sacked quarterbacks in all of football. Final 11 games of the year, he was sacked a total of 8 times. And that was one of your concerns, is Luck getting rid of the ball, not running into sacks himself, but also that offensive line being able to protect him. And all of a sudden, they were a dream scenario football team, which is you've got a good running game, you've got a great offensive line, an excellent defense. Those are the things you have to have to compete if you don't have a great quarterback. But they had all those things with a great quarterback. That's how you can win 10 of 11 games going into that playoff game against the Chiefs. I think the Colts should, the stock is only rising. And your point on the salary cap is another great one. A lot of people thought they have all this cap room. They'll go get Le'Veon Bell. They'll go make a flashy signing. They'll trade for Antonio or Odell. They made a few judicious signings. They bring in Justin Houston, a few other guys. But they didn't overspend. That cap room will roll over into next year, and they will be able to re-sign some of their own guys, and then maybe next year add one major impact player. But no, the Colts, under their new leadership, new head coach, like, they have been, they are in as good of a direction as, to me, any team in the NFL. I think you're totally right to be that high on them.
And when you can add 7 draft picks on defense, and that's another testament, is the fact that they had so many draft picks going into this year, into this year's draft, and to be positioned to sign your own players. So as these young stars get in a place where they need their second contract, you don't have to necessarily move on from them, or you don't have to leverage everything and not be able to add any other pieces. They're positioned to compete this year, and then should be multiple years in the future.
So now that the Colts are back in the conversation, where do they stack up against other teams in the AFC? Just to give people an idea of how high you are on them.
Well, this is the thing. I think the Colts' defense is going to be underrated. It's going to be unsung. It's going to be led by a guy, Darius Leonard, Rookie of the Year last year. Man, if you want to see a guy that's hungry, he talks about he wants to be MVP, win a Super Bowl. I like it. I like the way the team is built around these young players. And also, a couple other guys to watch. Watch Marlon Mack, the running back. If he can create some type of consistency behind that offensive line, man, he is a hidden gem. That's the reason why they decided. You know something? We believe we have talent here in-house. We're not going to spend that on L-Bell. And if they can duplicate the success that they had in last year's second rounder, where Darius Leonard was the defensive rookie of the year, Paris Campbell, man, if they can open up him as a wide receiver, because he is an elite athlete. He's one of the best athletes, one of the fastest at the combine. He's a big wide receiver, but he's more of a running back wide receiver compared to a wide receiver running back. If they can make him productive with Andrew Luck, if Andrew Luck can affect his career with that offense of T.Y. Hilton and several other, Eric Ebron, who had a tremendous year last year, the Colts are going to be right there at the end. My biggest worry is the ownership. He mentioned Edgerrin James. Edgerrin James didn't win no Super Bowl. Peyton won one Super Bowl. So the teams he talking about, they weren't even the best winning teams in the history. So what if they get home field advantage like Kansas City? They start looking out there. Someone like New England sneak up on them, Pittsburgh. So that owner will always be an issue there with the Colts.
Coach, stick around. Love having you here. You know, you being our favorite guest and everything.
I'm the favorite.
Coming up, 76ers star, Tobias Harris.
Tobias, our favorite.
Yeah, Tobias. Actually, Coach, you got to go.